Phil and I usually give these talks, and we've given talks on this subject in one form or another all around the world. And typically the audience is a bunch of hackers at a hacker conference or a very technical room full of mainframe people at something like Share. And we started debriefing after these talks and saying, you know, what we're getting a lot of feedback when we have these conversations is kind of violent agreement in that, yeah, this is important and we need to be talking about this and before it's too late. And so we said, well, let's just give it a shot and see if we can go someplace like RSA where we get a little bit of both, but we also get the business makers and decision makers at the conference as well. And so that's why we're here. So we're really, really glad that you guys are all here.
Right, yeah. Well, before we get too far, I got a little disclaimer here. So we're not here in the name of or speaking on behalf of our employer. We're just here because we like to do this kind of talking, and we think it's important for people to hear about it. Whoever's not looked at the slides ahead of time, who can tell me who this is? Not all at once. Hold on. And nobody? Really nobody?
I know.
I think you can tell us who.
So some of you probably know the name, maybe don't recognize the photo, but this guy by the name of Stuart Alsup. And in 1991, Stuart famously predicted that the last mainframe in the world would be unplugged 5 years later in 1996. Suffice to say, he was incorrect. And that picture was a photo for InfoSec Weekly where he was appropriately 10 years later in 2001 eating his words. The last mainframe did not get unplugged. In fact, we have a lot of mainframes around today, and the number is increasing. This slide right here is a list of companies and governments that depend on mainframes, and you can't read it for a reason. It used to be two slides. We condensed it to one. But I guarantee on this slide is a company that at least one, if not multiple, that everybody in here cares about. Anybody fly on an airplane to get here? Anybody like banking?
Yeah, anybody use a credit card?
Right, or have insurance, or use services from the government? I mean, these are things we take for granted, right? And they all rely on, at some level, in one of these companies, their mainframe for doing the heavy lifting in the back end.
So we've been doing this for a while now. I've been doing talking publicly about mainframe security and mainframe hacking and all that stuff for about 5 years. Chad's been doing it publicly for handful of years, three, four. We've both been in the mainframe circles for years and years and years. And the reason we started doing this is because there's sort of like four core pillars of concern that we have when it comes to this platform, right? So the first one is security disclosure. As you probably are aware of, none of the major vendors that support the mainframe platforms publicly disclose vulnerabilities. One company privately discloses vulnerabilities if you ask to have access to that list, but you got to sign a really long contract, right? But the rest of them don't even release that. They just say, you need to install this patch.
So what do you think happens in today's day and age? Because that actually is kind of a waning posture, right? So what do you think happens in today's day and age where you have bug bounties, you have public disclosure of vulnerabilities, right? What happens with the companies like Microsoft and Apple and Google when they come out and say, you know, we've got this vulnerability? Two things happen. One, the clock starts ticking, right? As soon as a critical patch comes out from Microsoft, basically they've made an implicit contract with you, if you care about your security, that you're gonna get that patched. Mm-hmm. Because you know that somewhere not too far down the line, someone's gonna reverse engineer that patch and figure out what it fixed and how to weaponize it and make it into some kind of exploit, right? So the clock starts ticking, good guys versus bad guys. But the second thing that happens, and it's a little more subtle, is it actually builds trust in that organization. Everybody in here has worked in, around, or with people who develop software, and we know that software is never perfect, right? You never get it right the first time. There's always patches, there's always bugs, always fixes that have to be done. And so it builds trust, right? It builds trust in these companies as they release these, as they release their vulnerabilities. And so what happens is kind of the opposite. If you have a platform, you know it's important, but it's not in the news, and you don't see vulnerabilities released for it, and it's not ever, you know, people aren't really talking about it being breached, you get this kind of false sense of security that, hey, it's probably okay.
Yeah, if your CISO, if your CISO's not getting reports, he's getting reports about all the vulnerabilities for everything else, and this platform has zero reporting. He has no idea if it's secure or not, because he doesn't know what's going on with it, right? He sees X vulnerabilities fixed on our Cisco boxes, X vulnerabilities fixed in Windows. Who knows how many vulnerabilities were fixed on the legacy platforms, right? That leads into challenges with infrastructure design. Why do I need to spend the money on a firewall, money on intrusion detection in front of my firewall if there's no vulnerabilities, right? There are vulnerabilities. We're going to show you a demonstration of one that we talk about frequently. But when you're designing, doing networking, and you know, all those kind of infrastructure design components, you don't think about what you need to do for this platform because you just think it's secure because you don't hear anything about it. Platform expertise, this shouldn't really come as a surprise to anyone here. Actually, I should ask real quick, who here works at a company that has a mainframe? Okay, all right. Platform expertise, everyone's kind of retiring real quick. IBM created the academic initiative to kind of stem the tide a little bit, but they are focused primarily on developers. Their core focus for all those academic initiatives, all the Master of the Mainframe contests and stuff, it's for developers, not for people who operate the mainframe. And there is zero training for mainframe security, right? I mean, we've been asked multiple times, hey, where do I go to get training on this? And we're like, well, until we make some, there's nowhere really to go.
So the pipeline that people are probably used to, where you had operations staff, right? Maybe tape operations, centralized operations, kind of growing up through systems programming, that really doesn't exist anymore. A lot of places outsource their operations, right? Really hard to hire a systems programmer unless they already have 30 years of experience. Training them happens in-house. And I started rephrasing this a couple years ago instead of just being a human capital problem, like, oh no, how are we gonna run this thing? To like, this is really a security problem. Because what do people that aren't familiar with systems do, right? They make the easy mistakes. They make the avoidable mistakes. And so as soon as we have to start replacing people with less experienced people and no place for them to get trained, they start making the easy mistakes. So one of the things we need you guys to do, if you're a decision maker or you have the ear of the decision maker, is start lobbying them to lobby your vendors to get this training, right? We need people that can provide the training. We need people that are willing to get the training. We need people to be able to get the hands on the platform. But that only happens with demand, right? And when it's too late, guess what that's gonna look like? It's not gonna look very good. You're gonna have a few companies who maybe do consulting and they'll happily come run it for you for a nice fee. But it won't be the same as having your own in-house staff.
In terms of stuff falling through the cracks, who here thinks their auditors are doing a great job at auditing the mainframe? Like nobody? So they're the stopgap. They're the last point for compliance to make sure that someone didn't make a mistake earlier on, right? And even they don't get the training. Like, we had to train ourselves, essentially, on the platform. So finally, the security industry, very little support for the platform, right? I mean, the majority of the products that exist today don't cover this platform.
So your industries, your companies have paid a tremendous amount of money to big label security vendors that, you know, filled up the expos down here. And without exception, almost none of them have support for this platform, whether it be, you know, vulnerability scanning or code coverage, secure coding, scanning, that kind of stuff. Not because they can't, not because they won't, but nobody's asking for it. And so this is, again, this what we need is people to ask their vendors, say, hey, we really need this as part of your platform. We can't afford to have it be an outlier because it's too much risk, right? It's like this creates an environment where we have this risk, and then we're going to get up at a point where we can't mitigate that risk.
Right, so all this stuff adds up to a whole bunch of risk for a critical component of your infrastructure, right? This is what happens when you're not giving it the due diligence and not securing it like you would the rest of your enterprise environment. Who here heard of anyone here from Sweden? Great. Have you heard of Logica? Yes. This is an article about a gentleman in Cambodia who hacked into a government mainframe, stole the witness protection database, the equivalent of the social security database, and the source code to their tax processing software. right? So imagine if someone stole the IRS software, like source code, and went through it to find out what thresholds they can push so they don't get caught for fraud, right? That's what he stole. And he stole all of it from a mainframe.
So funny aside about this that Phil didn't want me to tell you, but I'm going to anyway because the room's not full of people, is that back when this happened, had it gone a different way, this would have been a one-man presentation up here today, because one of the people that they investigated and wanted to talk to about this when it happened was Phil. Mm-hmm. The Swedish police contacted him because at that time, if you Googled mainframe hacking or mainframe vulnerabilities or exploits, this was the only guy literally in the world talking about it at the time. So they were very interested to talk to him. And as I understand, it did go over to Sweden and it turned out to be more of just like a night in the pub drinking. But
yeah, we just drank and talked about how cool it was, really.
But it was a little alarming.
Right. So outside of, you know, a breach, every once in a while, you hear about a mainframe outage. Now, the press and the companies, they don't call it a mainframe outage. But when this platform goes down, for whatever reason, it makes the news, right? We were talking about if Twitter went down, hopefully no one's from Twitter here, if it went down for 20 minutes, that's not making the CBS evening news, right? Visa, any of the airlines, American Airlines, they go down for an hour because of one of their critical systems goes down, that's making the news, right? So again, the lack of the training, all these other risks add up to major systemic risk to the enterprise that relies on this platform. Here's a fun statistic that we found.
Yeah, so this is, here's where some of this really starts to come home as far as this false, you know, this kind of false sense of security. So this is an actual IBM marketing slide, and I'm just gonna read it because I couldn't do it justice otherwise. It says Z-Systems 8.41 times more effective at preventing security incursions than other platforms. Like, who wouldn't want one of those? 8.41 times more effective.
Like, that's so specific.
I read this and I was like, maybe, how do you calculate 8.41 times more secure than the other platforms? But I understand the target demographic here being your CISOs and whomever, like this is a great thing. But, so we sent Phil, yesterday down to the Expo floor to talk to the nice folks at IBM Security and ask them where they came up with this number, and they're going to get back to us. But I'm fairly certain that they don't know the answer to that.
Yeah, I mean, there's no links. I looked. I wanted to know. I mean, because it's a stunning number, right? It prevents. It's better at preventing attacks, 8 times better. How? Why? Give me more marketing material. But there's no links. There's no star. There's no read more. It's just a picture. That means, I'm just like, that's... That's great. I mean, it's great for us if we're up here talking about how much more secure it is, but...
But the truth of the matter is, it does kind of underscore the point that if you ask people that really are not deeply ingrained in the platform, they'll probably tell you it's secure. I mean, I've been told it's not hackable. It's not susceptible to the normal types of exploits, which almost doesn't matter anymore because 90% of the exploits we have are because I was able to steal your credentials and use them. Versus just, you know, trying to barge through the front door. So.
Okay, so now that we've sort of primed it up here and got you all concerned about your mainframes and all that stuff, we're gonna talk a little bit about the platform. We're gonna walk you through, maybe do some help you understand what the mainframe looks like. There's a lot of people who responsible for assessing risk on a mainframe have never touched the mainframe. So usually when I do this, I like to use Windows networks. Because everyone understands a Windows network. Every enterprise has one. Everyone knows how it works. So I can translate between the two, and then that helps to understand what's going on. So Active Directory for identity management. On the mainframe, you're going to have RACF, ACF2, and Top Secret. And those are the three main security products that you use to manage access to the platform. Oracle, MSSQL, DB2. Everyone's probably heard of DB2, right? It's a large enterprise database, but fewer people have heard about IMS, but it's just a database platform for used by airlines and all kinds of stuff. So you have web applications, Kix transaction servers. Right? These slides are available, by the way. You don't need to be taking pictures. So web applications, like a website you go to, Kix. Just a Kix transaction server. Anyone here running Kix? Probably, yeah, there's a handful of people. So system administration, right? You have like command prompts and all kinds of fancy windows. You use TSO to do that kind of work on the mainframe. So you may have heard someone mention TSO or time sharing option. I'll show you what it looks like in a second. Remote access, right? TN3270 emulator. They might call it an emulator. Maybe you use attachmate or something like that, but that's how you can, so you know, it's RDP, TN3270. Then finally, event viewer, right? Or like syslog is something anyone who uses Linux should be familiar with. It's running on the platform. It also uses SMF. So SMF, you hear someone talking about SMF records and cutting SMF, they're just talking about logging and monitoring.
So the two things that if you walk out of here with, to have etched in your brain, one is the thing I've already mentioned, which is be skeptical. There's a false sense of security around this. It's not that the platform's not securable, it's very securable. But if you're not testing it, you're doing it wrong. You're testing everything else in your enterprise now, or you should be, and you have policies and procedures that apply to everything else. They should apply here. And the second thing is, it's just another computer, right? It's just a computer. Think of it that way, and when you frame it that way, and you have discussions either if you were in the decision-making chair and you're having discussions with the mainframe team, or if you're vice versa, it's just a computer. You have to treat it like any other computer in as much as you would test it, you would penetration test it, you would have all your policies applied to it, all the tools that are the gold standard for you should be being used on it, and if they're not able to, time to talk to those people.
Right, so to help drive that point home, we're gonna give you guys a little demo of sort of what it looks like. We're gonna walk through logging into TSO. We're going to log in, access some files, access some folders. Now they don't call it files and folders, but that doesn't really matter. We're gonna go through Kix, and then we're also gonna go through Unix. Unix comes with the operating system. It's part of the operating system. It drives the networking components and other pieces like WebSphere and whatnot. So here we go.
So if you use a mainframe or have used a mainframe, this will be very beyond basic. Point is just to demystify it, because
right.
People think about the platform as something larger than life, but really it has all the components of just any other computer.
So here I am logging in with a @AGA regular user. I'm at TSO. I'm using a 3270 emulator that's freely available. I'm going to show my user profile. Might be a little hard to read there, but I'm showing a user profile. I'm browsing what my user has access to. So I have no security attributes. I'm just a regular boring user. I'm gonna show what a file looks like so I can browse some files. So I listed a data set called source.asm. That's actually a folder. So to look inside that folder, I'm gonna send the same command but pass the option members. And now you can see there's a file in that folder called neo down at the bottom there. And to sort of help drive the point home that this is just a computer, nothing more different from anything else, I'm gonna run the netstat command and show you what's listening on the box. Just like you would do on any other machine, you can show what ports are open. And I'm gonna move over into the Unix side. So now I'm in what's called OMVS or USS. Same, I'm issuing regular commands you would expect to see in a Unix environment. I'm doing this all on a mainframe. So I'm showing the home folders for a bunch of users. I showed you what processes I was running. I'm gonna do the exact same netstat command in Unix. I'm gonna pipe it to grep to find the listening ports. It's like, it's just Unix, just a computer, files, folders. Everything's basically the same, they just call it something different, right? And then they have multiple page books about it. But now I'm gonna log off, I'm gonna exit out of this, and I'm gonna go into Kix. So I said Kix is kind of like a web server, right? So imagine, instead of going to TSO, so earlier I typed log on Apple ID TSO, now I'm gonna type log on Apple ID Kix. So this is like almost connecting to a different port on the system. And I'm gonna clear the screen, and I'm gonna type in a Kix transaction that I have access to called CEMT. And you just type it at the top there. You hit enter, boom, I'm in a transaction. Looks kinda like a web page if there was no fancy graphics or JavaScript. I type in choir, because that was one of the options, and now I'm gonna type system. And I can see kind of system attributes are going on in the system. That's Kix. It's not that complicated. It sounds and it seems complicated the first time you look at it, and you're like, what, did I just get a black screen? I can't do anything, there's no help, there's nothing. Once you figure out how to use it, it's really easy to use, and it's really easy to map through.
So, because it's just a computer, because it has a Unix-based looking interface, all the information you would ever want about how to operate the system is online. There's a no one will ever accuse IBM of not well documenting their system. In fact, if there's any complaints, it's way over documented. Yeah. It's hard to find a dummies guide or a frequently asked questions. You use the great user groups for that kind of stuff. But because it's just a computer, because it has I/O, because it's a von Neumann architecture, because it has protocols that are known to other people that don't use this platform, it's also very susceptible to garden variety hacking. And so most of the time, in the anatomy of a hack, it works a little something like this. Like I said earlier, I'm going to steal your credentials through some means, maybe phishing email, maybe be in a privileged position and just get them off the wire. TN3270, the client, is really just a beefed up Telnet protocol. And so everybody probably knows, you know, Telnet in the clear is kind of bad news. It's pretty easy to pick usernames and passwords off the wire if you're using Telnet. If you're encrypting it, that's great. It supports SSL, TLS. But if you're not using a certificate from a certificate authority with a client that actually checks the veracity of that certificate and verifies it, then you're just as susceptible to a man-in-the-middle attack capturing your user's credentials. A lot of people are moving towards multi-factor authentication on the mainframe. There's multiple products out there now available for it, but we're not there yet. And that's the single best thing you can do at this point from a stealing credentials perspective. So we steal your credentials, we're going to execute some unauthorized code on the system, make a full breach into the system, and then ideally try to escalate privileges. I'm going to show you a demonstration of what this looks like using tools that are freely available for your pen testing teams. So you can actually have this and try this. They are tools that your red teams will be familiar with and have already heard of, and they're very easy to use, and most of them are ones that either Phil or myself have written or added to existing frameworks.
So take a look at this slide for a second. If we got rid of the word mainframe up here, it's just regular pen testing, right? We added the word mainframe because it fills up the slide a little, but it's just pen testing. It's nothing special. It's just regular old pen testing.
So I'm going to give you a little demo of what this looks like. So while Phil was recording his demo the other day, I was actually sniffing on the wire between him and the mainframe, and I captured his credentials. So this is a real tool. It understands and speaks TN3270. I got myself in a privileged position between him and the mainframe and copied the commands he was typing. So you can see he typed TSO, at AGA was the username, and that bad dollar time is the password, is his password. And he was doing this over an encrypted connection. That's port 992 is the one we set up for TLS. So I was man in the middling this and able to do it because it was a self-signed certificate, right? So his client wasn't checking that. So I'm going to take this information. This is going to go pretty quick, but the point isn't really to teach you this, it's just to show you how simple it is. So this is a script and the variables I've got in there and I'm going to load this into Metasploit. So many of you may have heard of Metasploit. It's a free open source pen testing framework probably used by all of your organizations. So I have modules in there now that can speak mainframe, and this particular one uses the FTP protocol to upload programs and run them on the mainframe, which is very common. They all support it. And so what you see here, though, is this is loaded up into Metasploit. When it scrolls up to the top here, I've just got the remote host IP address, the port number that FTP is listening to, a few variables for my JCL, username, password that I stole from Phil. And the payload that I'm going to send it is a reverse shell. So the mainframe, it's going to backdoor the mainframe, it's going to reach back out to me and connect, and I'm going to have a shell on it without ever having to go through TSO or login. And that's what it looks like. It's that fast. That's how it happens. So I'm now in the Unix side of the mainframe. You can see my ID there. I check that I'm running ZOS, see if I can get super user authority right away. Can't check my profile, just like Phil showed you. I don't have any special attributes. So I'm probably a developer. It's probably a developer credentials or something that I stole and am now used to poke around on your mainframe. This is what it looks like. This is how it works. For both your teams that are going to penetration test your system and for the bad guys that are already lurking on your network. They may not know mainframe, but they're going to know how to operate in a Unix environment. So I didn't have any special authorities. So I've got another module that I put together in Metasploit earlier this week that looks for an unsecured APF authorized library. And it's going to try to run some code and basically get me to elevate my permissions. I'm not going to explain what that means, but if you want to ask afterwards, I'll be happy to explain it to you. But it was just one more job that I ran. I found one library that was insecure on that mainframe. It went through, compiled a special program that then ran as like a root user on the mainframe, and gave myself system special. And so if you know the RACF mainframe parlance, that's the equivalent of root. So this is game over, right? And that's how it works. And all I had to start with here was free open source, easily available tools, and a set of credentials that I stole. So if you don't think people can just steal your credentials, you need to read the newspaper more, because that happens all the time. And tools like this exist everywhere. In fact, they're the tools that we rely on to be able to test to see if our systems are vulnerable to these kinds of things. So the reason we showed you that and talked through some of this stuff is because I want you guys to do this. I want you to think about this. I want you to take this back and do it. Now, nobody is stupid enough to give FillerEye access to like their real mainframe, which
no, this is true,
as you might expect. And in fact, in most organizations, even the development or test system isn't really used for just sort of playing around. In fact, a lot of times the development system has more stringent SLAs because maybe you've got developers working 24 hours a day around the globe on the system. It really can't be down. But IBM have an answer for this, and this is a fantastic. So this is our development mainframe right here. I know it looks suspiciously like a Lenovo laptop, but that is our development mainframe. Yep. IBM makes a product called Z Development and Test, which is a virtualized mainframe. So it runs any of the mainframe operating systems like ZOS, and it has its own hypervisor, runs inside Linux. So you can get a license from this from IBM for a tiny fraction of the cost of what real hardware costs.
Yep.
And you can use it and use it for testing your tools, testing your teams, and more importantly, for training. So if you have people that are looking for a challenge in your organization and you agree that this is important, this is a great way to get them in front of something where they can really start digging into it and learning it before you actually go out and start testing things maybe on a development system or even on a production system. This is the way to do it, and it's where we've developed most of our tool sets.
And if you bring this down, who cares? It's mine. If I bring down, like he was saying, if I bring down the development environment, I wanted to do some testing at a company, and they said, if you bring down our dev environment, what are we paying the developers for that day? They can't do their job. It's not like a sandbox environment. It's where they're doing code development, right? So getting this kind of environment, if you have a Windows auditor, you expect them to have access to the platform so they can learn about it and see what certain options do and how it works, right? Same thing for this platform. If you're going to be securing it, you should probably know how it works, how it boots, where the configuration files are, and you can't really rely on an audit guide to do all that stuff for you because some of them aren't complete. So now we're going to talk, now that we've hopefully thoroughly scared everybody here for a bit, no? Okay. So we're going to talk about what you can do to prevent this kind of thing. So we've been harping on the fact that it's really just a component of your enterprise. It's not like some special snowflake. It's just, I mean, it's bigger and it's more expensive, but it's just a computer, right? They should never get a pass. They can handle whatever you throw at them, right? They can handle port scans. They can handle all kinds of security activities. So if you have enterprise processes that rely on security for patching SLAs and all that stuff, the mainframe must be enrolled into those processes, right? If you're doing PCI assessments and the person doing the assessment says, how come the mainframe's never been pen tested? They'll just accept that it's a legacy system, we don't need to test it, right? That's not really acceptable. Just enroll it into all your standard processes that exist for every other platform. Everything you do security-wise needs to be applied. I've seen places that have patches and they're like, well, patches end up in production in 6 months. Even though some of them might be critical security vulnerabilities that were fixed on Windows, who knows what their Windows SLA is off the top of their head? 24 hours for critical patches? 24, 12, 72 hours? Who knows what their SLA on the mainframe is? Right? It's probably much longer than that. And the other thing is, as you go back to your offices and you start saying, hey, we really should start digging into this platform, you're going to hear the word no a lot. You're going to get told, no, you can't do this, no, you can't do that. Don't take no for an answer. If the answer is no, the next question is, why not? Why do you get a pass? Why do you not need to follow these processes? Is executive management aware that you're not following these processes? Have they signed off on the fact that you're not following these processes? So next we're going to talk about asset. So what you're going to want to do is asset identification on the platform.
Right. So I'm going to interrupt Phil here. This is the kind of thing right here where we have a couple of these slides in here for the sole purpose of actually just saying, look, we don't need to talk about this. This is something you're doing already in your enterprise. And it's one of those things, like, if it doesn't apply equally to this system as well as the other ones, that is something that you need to address, right? There are other things that also apply to this, but this is another one. Like, you need to know. What are your applications? Who uses them? How's it set up? What are all the different endpoints? What are the protocols they use? You have this on your critical web apps that face customers. You have this on your mobile apps and probably some of your other back-end systems. You need to have it on this platform, too.
Yeah, I mean, realistically, if you're working for a company that can afford a mainframe, you're doing all of these activities for everything else, but you might not be doing it for the mainframe, right? So you probably should know what's on here. I've heard CISOs just say, yeah, that black box, we don't really worry about it too much. We don't really know what's on there. We just know it works and it's great, right? That's probably not the opinion a CISO should be having about a critical component of your infrastructure. Okay, so security requirements. Everyone probably has security requirements. Who knows what their mainframe security requirements are based on? If I went out today to write a Linux security requirement for a company, I would likely go to NIST. I would likely use public sources to create a baseline against, right? Not all the controls are applicable, fine, but you tailor it to the company, right? They want to be more secure, less secure, that's fine. I've been in places where the security baselines were written by the engineers, and they wrote them as high level and as wishy-washy as possible because the auditors were auditing against those security baselines, and they didn't want to get bothered too much. So we came in and rewrote them based on an actual standard. So this is the one that we recommend. It's the DoD DISA-STIG. Anybody here use that today? 1, 2, 3, that's great. So this is probably the only baseline. It's really an audit guide for the Department of Defense, but it's the only one that comprehensively covers the entire operating system. I was invited to give a talk, I won't name the organization, but I was invited to give a talk about how to develop, you know, security baselines and do testing on mainframes. And they said, hey, we have a great security guide, how come you don't talk about it in your presentation? Can you put a slide in? I was like, all right. So I took a look and then I put in my slide, the organization has a security guide, but it's missing the following components of the operating system. It doesn't cover Unix, it doesn't cover Kix, it doesn't cover web services. And they said, yeah, you don't need to include that in your talk anymore, you can just talk about the STIG. Right, because this is the standard. It covers everything in the operating system. Now, mind you, it's not perfect, right? It's for the Department of Defense. You're not the department. Well, you might be. Someone here might be. But generally, you're not going to be needing to meet the Department of Defense controls. But that's fine. You can tailor it to your environment. In fact, you should take the baseline and tailor it to your environment so that it makes sense, and then you can test it with these products. So Vanguard and Z-Secure will actually let you automate the testing of the STIG, right? So you can just go and do that test and see where you are in comparison to the STIG today, right? You can just run it, get a report, and you're like, whoa, we're way off. The other challenge with the STIG, and this is something that's going to take some work, is it only covers products that the DoD uses. So if you're using CA7 and they're using Control-M, it's not going to cover CA7. So you have to start understanding the product and start translating the Control-M controls to other products. All right, now we're going to move logging and monitoring.
Again, something else you should already be doing, right? So you're doing logging and monitoring on all your critical systems. You probably have some kind of correlation engine where the logs are going and getting federated and used. You probably have a SIM that you're feeding these things into. The mainframe is exceptionally good at logging and monitoring. It has a really good intrusion detection abilities. It has, filtering for outbound connections, egress filtering. It has an unbelievable logging of at a minutia level. But if you're not feeding that back into your enterprise organization, if you're not feeding that back into your SIM product, then what you're going to end up with is something like what happened at the logic breach.
Right, so that's actually a real funny story. So all their logs, so they were breached, the hacker was in there, he was doing all kinds of bad stuff. All their logs were going to /temp. So they're not trained on security incident response. They're not trained for security. They're operators. They know a hacker's in the system. What's the first thing they do? They reset the system. All the logs were gone. They lost all the logs because they didn't know where the logs were supposed to be. They put them in temp because they figured, if we need them, we can just go get them. And then once they rebooted the system, it deleted the temp folder, right? Because that's what it's for.
So anybody in here in DFIR, incident response, or do any of that kind of work, what you don't do if you know you've been breached or actively being breached is reboot the system, right? You lose your forensic evidence. You lose the ability to figure out what happened and who's doing what. You might isolate it, might cut it off from the network, but you don't just patently reboot it. And this is the problem, right? This stems back to what we talked about, the whole security culture, kind of a false sense of security, and that the staff that are operating this thing are not briefed or is not educated on the incident response like measures that the rest of your security team probably is. You probably have incident response people that are very good at network breaches, web breaches, and that kind of stuff. But what will you do when you find that breach on the mainframe? Are your operations and engineering staff versed on the incident response or the first 10 things they should do when that happens? If they are, come talk to me. Because generally speaking, that is not something that they've covered. And so this is a thing. In your organizations, this discipline needs to be built. And the bad news is it doesn't exist for this platform. So you need to go and talk to your vendors, talk to your executive management, or if you are the executive management, talk to your mainframe staff. All those people need to be at the table to figure out how are we going to respond to an incident when it happens, because it's going to happen. It's going to happen to somebody. Mm-hmm. And they need to know how they're going to respond to it, or the repercussions from that could potentially be catastrophic for way more than just that business, because of the slide we showed you. Those businesses affect all of us.
So we just listed some products here. There's a whole bunch of ways to get the logs off of the mainframe into your SIM environment. And then again, train your people on how to read type 80 records from SMF. Once they know how to read them, they'll just start consuming them. So back again, training your people. We know there's not much security training. That's why we're here to talk about it. But the people who are managing the platform, the people in the security department who are assessing the security of the platform, should probably be trained up on the platform. Now, you can't just send everyone to a SANS course for a week and then they come back and they're ready to go. They have to go attend platform training. They have to understand how the platform works, and then they can apply their skill set so that they're risk and control people. They can apply that to the platform. Same thing with security people. As I mentioned, SOC. They need to know what an alert should look like on this platform, just like they do for Linux and Windows. All right, so vulnerability scanning. Anyone here doing vulnerability scanning on their mainframe? No hands. It's a thing you need to do. It's a thing you must be doing. Not because it's very valuable, because the tools themselves actually don't support the platform. It's like Qualys, Nessus. You look on their website, they say, we don't support ZOS, right? But you can install Apache Tomcat in ZOS. You can put JBoss. You can put all kinds of weird things on the mainframe. They will catch those low-hanging fruit that attackers can use to get a foothold because they understand that component.
And guess what? Like, if you're running a Java application, or Phil mentioned JBoss, so JBoss, there was some great Java deserialization attacks that were responsible for a lot of ransomware that happened not that long ago. Mm-hmm. They run Java great. So and bundled versions of JBoss and Tomcat come with a lot of mainframe products. And guess what? The off-the-shelf exploits that would make use of those products, the vulnerable products on Linux or Windows, work perfectly against this system. You can run it against the mainframe that's running JBoss and get yourself a lovely little shell and whatever else you want to do, because it's Java, right? So it does all that translation, all the overhead for you. Again, maybe your attackers aren't sophisticated enough to really understand the mainframe, but they're going to know what to do with a Unix-looking command prompt. Enough.
Thanks. Again, with this, just enroll it in your processes. You're doing annual pen tests, scope in the mainframe, right? That's all you need to really be doing. It's not right. Like, I mean, we're not up here really talking about rocket science. Just include it in everything else you do security-wise in the enterprise. Add this to it, right? It's not insane. So I guess we're going to have a QA session. So if anyone has questions, I think there's mics. And I'll go through this slide real quick. So if you're thinking, like, what can I do Monday morning now? Okay, and I think we got this. First thing you're going to want to understand is how critical the mainframe is to your environment. How long can your environment go without the mainframe? Minutes, seconds, days, probably not weeks, right? Once you've done that, you have now the ability to say, look, we need, this system has the downtime of 2 seconds. That's how long we're allowed to be down. I need to go evaluate the security of this platform. Take the security baselines, compare it to the STIG. Do a gap assessment. And then figure out what applications rely on this platform. What business units rely on this platform? What assets exist on data assets? Is it HIPAA data? Is it Social Security? There are tools that will help you identify. So it's been around for a long time. It's kind of organic growth. There are tools that will help you identify the data that's on there and so that you can see, oh, this application has a lot of Social Security numbers. Maybe we should start looking into encrypting that, doing something with it. And then after you've done all that, so about 6 months from now, you should be scheduling your first vulnerability scans and pen tests. And I say it's going to take 6 months. It'll be 3 months of no thank yous. And then if you're persistent enough, it'll be okay, fine, but you can do it on this one system over here on Saturday at midnight. But we're going to have to be on the phone, and you're going to have to severely limit the scan, right? And then you just keep ramping up from there. So we want to say thank you. We know, yeah, come on up if you have any questions. It's okay, I'll repeat the question.
We can hear you.
That's all right. But thank you for doing this session. I think this is the only place that we got a mainframe taste in this conference. Three questions. You could choose to answer all three or answer the ones that you can. First question is, are all mainframes created equally? So HP, IBM, Unisys. Second question, is internal threat higher for mainframes than external threats? And the third is, how do you do static or dynamic code analysis on mainframe systems?
So the third one I'll take the easiest because it doesn't exist. So you look at some of the really common vendors that do code analysis, right? Static and dynamic code analysis. The only way to do it is the old-fashioned way, which is like scanning it yourself, right? But the tools for it don't exist. The exception is if the application's written in C or Java or something like that, you might be able to use that on an external tool that understands that language. But if it's, PL1 or COBOL or something like that, but those things don't exist. With the insider threat, I don't know that it's any more prevalent on the mainframe than other platforms. But what I will say is the people that know the most about this platform are in your organization, because unlike Linux and Windows, these things tend to have grown organically over years, and they have a lot of institutional knowledge stuff around it, so it's not like, it's not an out-of-the-box COS installation, right? It's going to be customized for your organization. So I don't know if your internal people are threats or not, but they know the most about it, right? And it might not be them that you have to worry about, but it's how easily could I get your system programmers' IDs and watch what they do, right? That kind of stuff.
To address your first question, the question was about what about the other platforms, right, that we typically include in this discussion? So HP Nonstop or Tandem, the Unisys platforms, and then AS400s. And then we primarily focus on ZOS because we felt like that's kind of the most important to the industries that we're in. But everything we talked about today is completely applicable to their platforms. However, huge caveat. If you thought there's very little research on ZOS security, there is exactly one slide deck about HP Nonstop hacking.
Right.
And it's 10 years old. No one's ever talked about it since. Unisys has zero discussions on the internet. Now, AS400 has an entire book, so that's why we don't really focus on that. Does that help answer the questions? That's fine.
I speak to people who don't really understand it. And one of the pushbacks I get is, hey, web systems or Windows platform get penetrated from the outside all the time. We're mainframe, we're secure, we're isolated. That's why we're more secure. But I don't know if the argument holds or not, or they're just blowing.
No,
if you wouldn't allow that a pass on a Windows system, you shouldn't allow it on this one. And even if you don't understand it well, you understand enough of it that it's just a computer, that the way things work. Well, show me how you know that, this person accessing this file can't do this. Like, show me, explain to me this, because if that was on Windows, I would ask you for this, this, and this. What does it look like here?
Yeah, I mean, what ultimately got me started was mainframe engineers telling me things about security. And I said, that's not how it works at all on the other side of the fence. There's no way this is real. And then I got one of those emulated mainframes, and I was like, no, they're very wrong. Like, I was right. So once you familiarize with yourself with the platform, you can start pushing back on some of the outrageous claims you might hear.
Or we gotta, I think they're going to kick us off.
Yeah, they're probably going to kick us off now.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.
I appreciate it. If you've got, we'll be out in the hallway. If you've got any questions, come talk to us.
Thank you.
Thank you.